The goal of this project is to capture the knowledge and experiences of change leaders to help inform other departments and colleges in transforming their STEM programs. We interviewed 8 individuals from institutions across the country. We asked them to share advice on how to better curriculum and pedagogy within their programs. This is what they had to say.
At UT, there's like 1,000 things you can earn. So it's all very confusing, but there's like minors and certificates and concentrations and flags. And so we added a stamp because why not? Obviously we needed one more thing that people could earn. But the idea is that you take so many of our CS ethics classes we have, and then also you take so many technical classes that have social impact discussions woven through them. And so we're in the process now of trying to weave those through some of our technical classes. The AI ones are pretty easy, low hanging fruit, making sure that we try to weave those right into operating systems and things like that. It's a little bit harder, but doable. And then we instituted, we had our 2 upper division ethics courses, but we instituted an ethical foundations of computer science for our freshmen that is not required yet, but I hope to make it required. But basically that causes people to start thinking critically about what our field is doing. And just as you do that, and you sort of highlight that it's not a meritocracy, right? And all this kind of stuff, like just as you get people thinking, then that sort of shifts the culture. But the thing that has been more successful is they have study nights where people come and study together. I think it's hard for people to admit one-on-one that they need help. And when I set up the tutoring in my class, it's a little bit different because I reach out and I'm like, hey, I think you might need some help going over these concepts. Would you mind if I ask somebody for you, right? And so that's a little bit different. So we have the group study nights. We've also increased the number of TAs in the classes. And we've basically increased them to the point where, you know, until the faculty are like, I can't manage any more TAs.
So the biggest change I made at Mines was adding peer mentors. So we added a peer mentoring program that actually was initially funded by NCWIT. Thank you, NCWIT. We added, and it still exists today. So thank you, NCWIT, for launching us. So we added peer mentors to the program, where these mentors, every student in our intro to computing class had to meet with their mentors. The number of times you had to meet depended on, like if you were a first year, you had to meet more than if you were a second year, for example, student. And so adding those peer mentors to be a sounding board for advice on just college in general, as well as being available to answer questions, technical questions related to the course, was a huge positive for our environment and what the students thought about computing. And how I measured that was pre-post surveys.
This was an online class we did it in, but we're also doing it in in-person classes, changing the online climate through the students themselves. And the way we did it is by changing some things in the curriculum of this class. And so, as I said, the essence of the approach is to put bits and pieces of inclusive design know-how into mainstream CS classes. And the results were that the students who experienced these interventions reported feeling more included in the computer science major than they had before, bonded better with their teams also, and their interest in accommodating diverse users changed, and they created more inclusive technology designs, which was a set of activities that enabled students to learn something called the GenderMag Cognitive Styles, which GenderMag is an inclusive design method. So they were learning just cognitive styles that pertain to inclusivity. And then we have a set of heuristics that enable them to apply those things to the software they're creating as they design. And then the third was actually designing the stuff that they had to design for their courses anyway.
We have a CS10, which is the beauty and joy of computing. That course is really fun. You know, you program in Snap and you learn things like recursion and high order functions. Students take that and they're like, oh my gosh, I love CS, but there's no way I'm moving on because I know your 61 series is like, makes people not love life. And so convincing them to stay in, even after they got maybe a C in the first prereq, and telling them to hang in there, especially if they're in CS scholars. So encouraging them and supporting them academically so that they would succeed, like providing tutoring. Like now CS scholars, every student has the option of a one-on-one tutor in the first course in our sequence. I teach that pedagogy class and I make everyone tutor a CS scholar because we didn't have funding to support like tutoring all of the students, right? Things like that really, really help. So how will we set up this program? We're like, well, we don't have funding. So what can we do with our time to make this happen? So we cohorted them for the first two courses, the whole first year. We cohorted them in our courses so that CS scholars had the same exact discussion and the same lab. Lecture is obviously giant for everyone. For a discussion and lab, they took that together. And then we also had a seminar that I teach, which is the climate, the CS climate and academia and industry, where we discuss, you know, issues of like inclusion and access and what makes CS so homogenous and how do you combat that, things like that. And so they take the seminar and their lab and their discussion together for the first two semesters. And then they also get that academic support that I mentioned, which wasn't a lot of work, right? We just had to cohort them, which was some administrative work, but we have to schedule them for something anyway. So we just set aside a section in a lab that was only for them and cross-checked all their schedules so that they'd fit and had them take the seminar and then went from there. It's very low overhead.
But one of the things that we are trying to think about is, you know, how do we create sort of culturally competent pedagogy or assignments? So, you know, things that are actually going to be of interest to large groups of people. So, for example, in our intro series, we're considering making some of our homework assignments be a little bit more choose your own adventure-ish. So for example, if someone is interested in the intersection of biology and computer science, how could they explore that in an assignment? Or if they're really interested in the environment and computer science, how could they explore that in the environment? I think that for women in particular, making connections with computing on how they can make an impact is really, really important. And so we want to start that early on.
NCWIT has this fantastic list of I think it's 81 things that you can do to make your courses and department more inclusive. And we did like 77 of them or something. So we did quite a few of them. We need more lists like that. You know, if you care about making your culture better, these are the things you should do. If you care about making sure your courses are collaborative, these are the things you should do.